I'll just wait for the numbers to increase and then we'll start
Yes.
with the webinar.
Yeah.
Hello everyone. I welcome you all to this webinar, Crafting by the Loom, organized by Textile Design Department, NIFT Gandhinagar, on the occasion of the 6th National Handloom Day. I request all the participants who are joining us to post their questions in the Q&A box provided. These shall be answered towards the end of this webinar by the panelists. We have a distinguished panel of experts with us, each of whom have a very special connection with handloom and handwoven textiles. I start the introductions with Dr. Sudha Dhingra, a professor in Textile Design Department of NIFT, New Delhi. She has been successful in sensitizing her students to Indian handlooms and crafts through her teaching. She has co-authored books on textiles of the Northeast and textbooks on traditional Indian textiles for CBSE. She has worked with the handloom weavers of Bastar and Kotpar for her doctoral research. Welcome to the webinar, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you.
Our next panelist, Mr. Jamal Kidwai, is a social entrepreneur and founder of Baragaon Weaves that works for handloom weavers of Uttar Pradesh, Jammu and Kashmir. Mr. Kidwai is also director and consultant at Aman Public Charitable Trust and on governing boards of several NGOs. As a social writer, Mr. Kidwai has written about conflict and politics. Welcome, Mr. Kidwai. We also have with us Ms. Juhi Pandey, a craft development professional and currently the technical head at Neela House, which is a part of the Lady Bamford Foundation that supports creative developments in natural dyes and handloom textile for traditional artisanal communities in Rajasthan. Ms. Pandey is an alumni of NIFT and NID and has extensively worked in the field of handicrafts and handloom. Welcome to the seminar, Juhi.
Thank you.
Finally, we have Mr. Purushottam Siju, a weaver and artisan designer who practices handloom weaving in the village of Bhujori, district of Kutch in Gujarat. Purushottam Bhai has incorporated new yarns in his traditional practice and has won an award of excellence from the World Craft Council for his handwoven textiles. He represents the new age, young and dynamic weavers of India and has also done business development course from Samaya Kala Vidyalaya Kutch. Aapka swagat hai Purushottam Bhai.
Namaste ji.
I begin with the first discussion point of this webinar, which is why handloom or what makes handwoven textiles special? Purushottam Bhai, main aapse shuru karna chahungi. Aapke vichar se हथकरघा या हैंडलूम से बना कपड़ा वस्त्र खास क्यों है?
देख हैंडलूम ये भारत अपना देश है जो संस्कृति से जुड़ा हुआ है, तो पहले तो जो ऋषि मुनि थे वो पत्तों को जोड़ के कपड़ा बनाया है, तब से चला आ रहा है। तो ये एक हैंडलूम का जो नेचुरल है, जो कॉटन से हैंडस्पन है, वुल से है, जो चीज रियल है उसको जो फायदे हैं, उसको जो पुराने जमाने में जो पहना करते थे, हमारे यहाँ जो ट्रेडिशनल रबारी रोग है जो मैंने पीछे ढाबड़ा लगाया है, तो वो लोग वहाँ तक ही था कि वो लोग भेड़ बकरियों से जो वुल निकलता था वो स्पिनिंग करके वीवर को देते थे और वीवर उनको वीविंग करके वापस उनको उनको ही कपड़ा दे देते। तो मतलब एक सिर्फ बिजनेस नहीं है, एक रिलेशनशिप है, एक फैमिली है, एक परिवार है, एक भावना है, उससे जुड़ा हुआ ये हैंडलूम का काम है। और जब वीवर वीविंग करता है तो सिर्फ ताना बाना नहीं बुनता है, उसकी मन की कल्पना है, उसके जुड़ा हुआ एक एक तार से जो आत्मा से निकलती हुई जो भावना है वो जुड़ के जो बुनता है वो भी साथ में देता है, सिर्फ कपड़ा नहीं देता है लीवर। तो ये खासियत है लीवर की।
Juhi, what are your views on it? He's talked about traditions and the tana bana of life, but in this age of AI and automation, why handloom? You are on mute, sorry.
I'm on mute, sorry. No, so, you know, the age of AI and automation can be where it is. Lekin hamari jo ye sanskriti hai kabhi jayegi nahi. If it had to go, and when industrialization was in its peak, and introduced to our country, it may have been lost right then and there. But iski main puri jo acknowledgement jo deti hu, I give it to our communities of weavers and craftspeople who have kept it alive. Aur ye iski ye khasiyat hai because it's their life, it's their way of living. Hum sab jo hain, humne in sab cheezon ko adopt aur अडॉप्ट किया है और प्रमोट किया है, लेकिन ये इनकी संस्कृति में, इनके रहन सहन में ही था. और इफ़ यू सी एनी ह्यूमन रेस, एनी सोसाइटी टू वर्क विथ यू, योर थ्री बेसिक नीड्स, रोटी, कपड़ा, मकान, या एंड दैट वाज फुलफिल्ड बाय द कम्युनिटीज वर्किंग विथ ईच अदर. जैसे पुरुषोत्तम भाई ने बोला कि ऊन आपको आपके मालधारियों से मिलता था, फिर कताई भी उनकी औरतें करती थी, और फिर कताई करके वो लोग बनकरों के पास आते थे, बनकर उनके लिए भी बनाते थे, अपने लिए भी बनाते थे और लोगों के लिए भी बनाते थे, और उस एक्सचेंज में इनको अपनी और जो ज़रूरतें होती थी वो मिलती थी. सो इट्स अ दैट इज़ द रिचनेस ऑफ आर हैंडलूम टेक्सटाइल्स, आर क्राफ्ट स्पेसेस. और ये जो आदान प्रदान है इज वॉट इज़ द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट एस्पेक्ट फॉर अस ऑल्सो टू लर्न टूडे. And I think that's the beauty of why a lot of us, because we are the earth, the nature is so important in our lives that ye ek madhyam hai jisse hum usse jude hue hain. And that's the beauty of where I see handlooms being very important for us even today. You're on mute.
You're on mute.
Sorry about that. So, Mr. Kidwai, what is your take on it now? You're talking about trade and barter and how it sustained the traditional practices. What is?
You know, I agree with what Pushottam Bhai and Juhi have just said, and I don't want to repeat that. I completely endorse that. Those are my sentiments also. But in my last limited time, I'm not a designer, neither I'm a textile person. The reason I am invested both in terms of emotion and in terms of energy in this sector is because I find that in this current times, this sector provides a very sustainable livelihood to a very large number of people. I mean, my sort of very little research tells me that one loom can actually provide a very dignified livelihood to maybe 7 or 8 spinners, 6 or 7, 4 or 5 family members. It is done at home. Most of the looms, at least where I work in Barabanki, UP, looms are home-based. They work in their leisure at times when they want to work. They don't have to go out and do laboring work, which is very alien to them, which is not very dignified. They make products which are very sensitive and they can identify with all those things which Pushottam Bhai and Juhi have said. So for me, in the current times when we are always talking of job creation, etc., I think this, if there is more demand for handloom, and I think the demand for handloom is growing across the world, this is a very, very sustainable, and given the consciousness of, you know, climate change and environmentally friendly stuff, this is a very, very important sector for dignified livelihood, as I say.
Sudha ma'am, please share your views about handlooms. You've been teaching about.
Hearing from Purushottam, of course, he knows that it's their dharohar, you know, it's their heritage that they have, they're working with. But I would also say that this sector has many strengths. One is that there is a uniqueness in terms of transfer of knowledge. You know, a father who's a weaver, he will also teach the children in the house, start learning how to do things, how to prepare a loom. So that transfer of knowledge is very automatic and simple in the traditional communities. And that is why maybe the handloom sector has survived in our country. Secondly, they are very open to innovation. You know, you will find that in most of the sectors where our designers are working or students are working, the weaver gets excited and starts working with them as a partner. And they're very open to innovation because they know how to make changes in their looms, or, you know, they're masters of their skill. Then there is a flexibility of production. You know, you can get two saris woven from cotton, or you can get in one warp, you can put 60 saris in one time in villages in West Bengal and places, right? And there is so much of diversity in handlooms. You know, you will find, you go to Northeast, there's a different kind of a texture, there's a different kind of motif. You go to South of India, there's a different texture. Motifs would also change. A paisley which looks different in Kashmir might look very different in Banaras, or might look very different in, in West Bengal and things. So, you know, there is so much of wealth in this sector in terms of knowledge, in terms of innovation, that, you know, I think we are very fortunate to be in India where there are so many handlooms. You know, one of the statistics says that there are 3.9 million people who are sustaining on handloom sector. Although we don't have a count of actual count of looms, but as Jamal said, the whole family and spinners would survive on, you know, seven spinners might survive on one loom. So it's amazing, actually. It's wonderful. Yeah.
Very true, ma'am. So now let's move on to another aspect of handlooms, and let's try to see the journey of these handloom textiles. And for this, I will request each of the speakers to talk about their own experiences and tell us about how they have seen handlooms evolve, or hand-woven textiles evolve in front of them. So, Sudha ma'am, I'll start with you this time. So, can you share your experiences that you've had with the Bastar and the Kotpart textiles, and how the practices there have evolved?
Yeah, just a minute. You see the presentation now? Yeah.
Yes, we can.
Yeah. Okay. So I had an opportunity to work very closely with the weavers in Bastar and Kotpart. Although with students, I've been to many, many sectors of handloom in the country. But my experience of, I would like to share here my experience with the weavers of Bastar and Kotpart. If you've been to the area, you would know it's a very beautiful landscape. The paddy fields, the trees, and people are very colorful, very simple, very sustainable living they have. You know, even the packaging, I would say, is leaves. And, you know, they're very conscious of their environment. They are protectors of their forest, and they have a lot of indigenous knowledge in terms of what kind of medicine can come from what leaf, or what kind of dye can come from different flowers and leaves. And they're very skilled. You will find in a regular weekly hut, you will find them sitting and making mats, or, you know, jewelry and things like that in their regular day-to-day life also. They used to wear these tribal people of this area. You know, this belt is known for their tribal population. And these people used to wear a traditional textile, which I studied for my doctoral studies, which was a pata, a handloom pata. And what you see this female wearing is a 14s and 20s count thick cotton, which has been bordered with a arl dyed yarns. Arl is a dye which comes from the roots of a tree, Morinda citrifolia. And on the left hand side, you see a man wearing a turban, which is known as feta, which was normally worn on special occasions. But when I started my study in 2008, and I went and visited very often this region, I realized that tribals have also shifted to wearing these synthetics, brightly printed synthetics, because they were cheaper, they were very easy to maintain, and they were very, very colorful. And these people had a very colorful kind, you know, they had an attraction for these colors. mostly the men as well as women. Even the men are very fashionable in terms of doing little makeup and, you know, wearing jewelry. But they were all wearing these kind of synthetic material for obvious reason of maintenance and cost. A traditional pata is like this, which is, as I told you, is very thick, but the dimensions are also smaller than a sari. And most of the tribals had one in their family for the reasons of, you know, heritage or for the reasons of, you know, to wear it for celebrations and all. But the weavers of Kotpad and Nagarnar and Tokapal, the areas in Bastar where I studied, they were not able to gather any local market. The local people used to wear, this was demonstrated to me, because they are wearing synthetic saris like this now. But this is how a pata was wearing, was worn. One style worn at home and the other style on the right hand side was worn when they go out in the market so that they can fetch fruits and things from the heart or from the forest in the front flap. There were some special patas also made, which were to be gifted during the weddings. And there were some very peculiar patterns which I saw in this area. These were the ceremonial patas, which have not been made for many, many years now. They have got inspiration from temples of this area, Jagdalpur. You know, they worship Mata. So they have these temples and, you know, all those kind of motifs on their textiles. What I found was that this loom, which is a very simple pit loom, was a sacred object in their houses. You know, these looms were very old. Nobody knew when they bought it because they have inherited from their parents. The local, there was no shop selling any loom. The carpenters were there who would come and do a little repair. And if the loom was totally discarded because of reasons of, say, termite and things, even then the weavers would not burn it as a fuel or anything. They used to put it away or they used to immerse it in water because they used to feel that there is, these things are sacred for us. It was a very simple two harness loom, spit loom, which everybody, almost everybody in their houses had. And in one go, they used to wear, they used to put four patas, which is smaller, or saris. They started making around 2007-8, they started making saris for the commercial market. Most of the houses had a shed outside the house or sometimes inside the house to place the loom in a pit loom. The extra weft ornamentation, whatever patterns were forming, were not referred to, you know, they were not referring to any kind of a graph or any kind of a picture. They were just doing it by memory. Whatever they could see around themselves, they would make it. And when you ask them, they would say, oh, this is a makhi, or this is a, you know, jonk, leech, or a butterfly, you know, those kind of shapes. But they were so expert in doing these by memory that, you know, and the distancing, there were no tapes, measuring tapes or anything used for in their weaving. Because these textiles were worn by the tribals, and tribals had a liking for very obvious, very naive kind of forms. So they were making these very simple things which they would see around themselves. These were inspired from nature, mundane things like, you know, the umbrellas or the boats or whatever, you know, the reptiles and the butterflies they would see, they would depict it on their textiles. And there were only four borders, but these borders were not put on the pata border. They were the borders which were used in the pallu to ornament it a little bit more. And around 2008, 2009, they started making these very fine, very intricate kind of patterns, especially for the, you know, the international market. There were a few designers who were going and picking up these things for, because these were of interest to international audience. They were very conversational kind of pieces. So very few weavers were making these and, you know, very intricate kind of things with, and they had difficulty in selling these because these were not open for the domestic market. And domestic market was actually not showing any interest and their local market was already lost. For the domestic market, they were making saris like this, you know, mercerized cotton with eri or with tussar. So my research led me to understand that, you know, people wanted more variety. Secondly, the fabric was very thick. The original fabric was very thick. Some of the weavers also said that they had a problem in working with mercerized thread, you know. So I decided to do a collection of fabrics for garments and for home fashions, because it was so thick that it was very appropriate to be adopted for home fashions. And I met this weaver through Crafts Council shop in Kamla, the Kamla shop. And then he was in Crafts Museum and I experimented with him for a month and, spoke to him every day to see how adaptive he is to understanding drawings and things like that, you know, understood the vocabulary that they were using. So this all went on in Delhi Crafts Museum. And after that, before this also I had gone to the cluster, but after this, when I went, he introduced me to many, many weavers and I could put together a small collection of textiles, which were converted into very simple garments. The mandate that I kept for myself was that I will not change the motif. I will keep the motif the same, traditional motif. I will not change the dye. They were able to do two or three different colors of aal out of the natural dye. They were able to achieve two or three different reds. And also that I could not make a change in the loom. So it has to be very, very simple fabrics that would be made. And the garmenting was done here with the help of one of our fashion design alumni from Delhi. I'm showing you few. Then when I was doing dupattas, I realized that I can copy some of those temple motifs that they were making in their patas, which I was able to make in my designs for these dupattas and some of the saris also. And then a collection of home textiles was made where I made some assorted runners and table mats. When I kept on working with these weavers in Kotpad, to whom Madhusudan Panika had introduced me, I realized that they were very open to new ideas. They were able to work with short width fabrics. I introduced two new colors because my feedback that I got from my survey in Delhi was that, people don't want to buy too much of whites and reds only. And if I wanted to expand the market, I introduced indigo and the gray from the Ratan Jyot, which I got it dyed from Dastakar Andhra, and introduced these two colors so that the product remains true to the natural dyeing traditions. And collections of cushion covers. Again, you can see these are all the traditional motifs of butterfly, the borders which they were making. So, the weavers actually quite quickly picked up the skill of looking at it from the paper and making it on the textile. And I kept in view that because they do not measure, I kept it very open-ended that, they can change certain forms here and there. For example, my weaver, one day he said that I want to do something different and he made this with the Madia and the Mudia, the tribals that they sometimes make on certain pieces. So he made these and I really liked these and added it in my work, in my collection. These are all the motifs that they have been doing, different kinds of fishes and all that they do. And I especially asked Sumita to let me show this today because I was enthralled with the ingenuity and the innovation that these weavers could do with me during a very, during a short duration. And they were very enthusiastic. Earlier, they never knew how these products were used, in a house because they were not to any urban house. But gradually, when they visited my place and they saw, they were very open to doing this. And he is the weaver who introduced me to all the weavers. And unfortunately, he passed away on Sunday, 2nd of August, last Sunday, he passed away. So I would like to end my presentation by paying my respects to him, that he was one of the strongest link for me for last so many years, that he introduced me to people and always kept in touch with me. Thank you.
Thank you for this wonderful presentation, Dr. Sudha. I now request Mr. Kidwai to share the journey of Bada Gaon Weaves with us. How has been that for you? How have you seen it?
Yeah, so I, can you hear me? Yeah. As I had already said that I'm not really a designer, and I work with a team of designers. The reason I got into it was to provide regular livelihood to Bada Gaon weavers and few weavers in Kashmir, Pashmina weavers in Kashmir. Now, when we began weaving when we entered Bada Gaon cluster and started this project of weaving, what we realized was that the weavers had actually forgotten in many ways their own traditional weaving. What they were doing was something which was very market oriented, very sort of weaving synthetic stoles, which were not very sustainable, which were one use kind of weaving. In the neighboring place, they were doing ari work, or what is typically called jardozi, which was again one time sort of they were sticking beads on the on dupattas and sarees and fabric. So when we began work, our big challenge was to make things which they do very simple weaving in pit looms, and our sort of challenge was to make them revive or do the weaving which they were doing earlier. And many of them, frankly, had forgotten doing that. So thanks to my young colleague and designer, who was actually from NIFT, Shriya Bhattacharya, she went to Badagaon and she sat with the weavers and she convinced them to begin making fabric, simple cotton 2x16 kind of fabric. They were very resistant to do that, but and they said that who's going to buy it, etc. They were not very convinced. But soon we tried hard and inspired one or two of them to do it, and we assured them that whatever they make, we will keep buying from them. And thanks to, I must say, another marketing place called Jaipur.com, they saw our stuff and they said that this is excellent fabric which you are doing and we would like to get more. And that's how our weaving began. And then again, my young designers went back to the weavers and said, why don't you try and making sarees? Why don't you want to make dupattas? They did that. They had to adopt to new designs, which they did. And you can see all that on our website called badagaonweaves.com. All those things are displayed there. And then we went a step ahead. We, in the same village, we took those sarees and dupattas to the zardozi walas. To the ari work walas, which is typically called zardozi. And again, our designers sat with them and encouraged them and convinced them to do something which is a bit more tedious, but more sustainable, and which will also give them a newer skill. So they did that, and we did a kind of a value addition. And it was happening in the same village, and it's still happening in the same village. It's a very small cluster. Then we went to another close by village and took that fabric, handloom fabric, to the chicken curry workers and asked them. A lot of people were very sort of reluctant to do chicken curry or zardozi on hand woven fabric, because in these days even chicken curry workers are used to working only on mill made fabric, which is tougher. And but we told them this is the traditional way of doing it. This is, and because if you do this, people will feel it more comfortable and it will look more elegant and it will look more authentic. So that's how we have done it. And similarly in Kashmir, we have tried to revive, and in fact we have all our products are those which are hand spun and hand woven. Slow over the last many years, what is happening in Kashmir is that hand spun pashmina is going out of fashion for various reasons, for marketing reasons, for it's tedious, there's not enough pay. They make only 10 grams in 3 days, and if suppose a shawl is of 200 grams, people want it quickly, short orders, short timelines. So it's all mill-made yarn. But we are trying to do that because we also believe, like we believe that design, marketing and livelihood and good quality can go hand in hand. Tradition and modern markets can exist. What we need to do is educate the weaver, educate the customer. And these are days where there is online things happening. There are so many platforms. So education and combining tradition with modernity are things which are very doable. And I must say, in a very small way, it's a drop in the ocean, but we are trying to do that. Thank you.
But truly inspiring, absolutely inspiring. Pushottam bhai, ab main aap se puchna chahungi ki aapne apne zindagi mein, aapne apne samne handloom mein kya kya badlav dekhe hain, kya kya aapne dekha hai usme, kaise cheeze धीरे धीरे बदल रही है हैंडलूम में, आप उसके और अपनी आप अपने सफर के बारे में कुछ बताएं।
जैसे ट्रेडिशनल जो लोकल मार्केट था वहाँ सिर्फ व्यापारी के लिए बना देते, वो फिर यहाँ तक मार्केट था, फिर वहाँ से फिर लूम में चेंज आया, जो थ्रो शटल था, जो एक पार्ट वीव करके दो पार्ट ज्वाइंट करके तब जाके बड़ा पन्ना बनता था, फिर फटका लूम आने के बाद बड़ा पन्ना आने लगा, यान चेंज हुआ, सिंथेटिक यान जो एक्रेलिक आया, जो 82 के आसपास अराउंड आया, उसके बाद क्या हुआ, एक साथ तो फास्ट बड़े पन्ने में वीविंग होने लगा और एक्रिलिक का यान का जो कलर थे वो बहुत ही बहुत सारे कलर आए और फास्टनेस आए, जिसके कारण पूरे मार्केट में एक ढाबड़े में से शॉल कन्वर्ट हुई, जो शॉल लोगों को बहुत ही अच्छे लगने लगी और उसका मार्केट बहुत ही चला, जिसकी वजह से कच्छ में काफी एक लेवल से बहुत ही ऊपर कच्छ की वीविंग को पहचाना गया। और उसके बाद क्या हुआ कि एक लिमिट होती है, कोई चीज अगर बल्क में जाती है ना, या उसको जितना प्रोडक्शन ज्यादा होता है उतना मेरे हिसाब से हैंडलूम और वीविंग क्षेत्र में वो थोड़ा खतरा माना जाता है। इसीलिए हमारे इसी अक्रेलिक यान में जो बढ़ोतरी आई, उसी के कारण दिक्कत क्या हुआ कि जहाँ से लुधियाना से यान आता था तो उन लोगों ने सोचा कि ये कच्छ वाले इतना यान कर क्या रहे हैं, तो उन्होंने देखा तो ये तो शॉल बना के बेच रहे हैं। तो उन्होंने जब पावर रूम में कॉपी की तो वो चीज में बहुत दिक्कत हुई, तो उस टाइम पूरा कच्छ के वीवर को बहुत दिक्कत हुई। पर एक चीज है कि आपको वो फेस झेलना पड़ेगा और उसका रास्ता निकालना पड़ेगा। तो यहाँ के लोगों ने क्या किया कि यान वेरिएशन किए, मलबरी सिल्क लाया, तसर सिल्क लाया और मरीनो जो 260 है, तो वो आने के बाद क्या हुआ कि हम लोगों ने जो हमारा ट्रेडिशनल बोटिक था उन्होंने कॉपी तो किया पर वो परफेक्टली नहीं कर पाए। तो हमने क्या किया, उसका जो सिमिलर जो प्लेसमेंट था उसमें चेंज कर दिया, प्रोडक्ट में हमने बहुत सारे चेंजेस किए और डिजाइन बहुत बारीक करने लगे, क्योंकि हाथ बहुत बारीक कर सकता है, मशीन की लिमिटेशन है। तो हमने उन सारी चीजों को हमने कवरिंग कर लिया, जिसकी वजह से फिर हम वापस वीविंग में आए। और उसके बाद क्या हुआ कि नई जनरेशन, जैसे मैंने डिजाइन क्लास किया है, तो जैसे ही नए लोग डिजाइन क्लास करने के बाद वीविंग में आए तो उनको लगा कि नहीं नहीं जो मेरे वीविंग में है मैं उसमें बहुत कुछ कर सकता हूँ, और मैं थैंक्सफुल हूँ जो मेरे दादाजी मेरे पिताजी सब लोग ये कर रहे हैं और वो चीज मुझे आज यहाँ मिल रही है। और एक चीज बहुत अच्छी लगती है कि कोई हमें दिल्ली से कॉल करता है कि हम आपसे मिलना चाहते हैं, आपका काम देखना चाहते हैं, हमारे घर आते हैं और वो हमारा काम देखते हैं, तो हमें ऐसा लगता है कि हम इस काम की वजह से हैं और यही हमारी पहचान है। अगर इसी पहचान को हम ही सही तरह से रखेंगे, जैसे हमारे बुजुर्ग पिताजी दादाजी और उससे भी आगे, और यही चीज अब हमारी जिम्मेदारी है। तो हमारी जिम्मेदारी ये है कि कारीगर को ना करना भी आना चाहिए, सिर्फ हार नहीं होना चाहिए। अगर हर बार आप हार करोगे तो कभी आप हार जाओगे, तो ना किस चीज में करना है और ना किस चीज में करना है वो जरूरी है। तो इसलिए अब क्या है कि लोग इसमें नई जनरेशन आ रही है, और बीच में वो दौर था तब कुछ लूम बहुत कम हो गई थी और कच्छ में बहुत सारी फैक्ट्रीज आई थी तो लोग काफी फैक्ट्रीज में गए थे। पर अब क्या हो रहा है, आज की डेट में लोग फैक्ट्री में जा रहे हैं, वो लोग भी घर पे आके 3-4 घंटे लूम तो चालू ही है। तो आज की डेट में कच्छ की कंडीशन ये है कि 4 गुना लूम बढ़ गई है, तो ये बहुत अच्छी बात है। और नई जनरेशन बहुत इसमें आना चाहते हैं, और एक तो सोशल मीडिया है, लोग यही भी चाहते हैं कि मेरे नाम से मेरी ब्रांड से मुझे पहचाना जाए, मेरे काम से पहचाना जाए, मेरे कलेक्शन हो, और ये सब सोच अब बढ़ने लगी है। और एक चीज है कि जो एजुकेशन बहुत महत्व रखता है, उससे आप खुलापन से काम कर सकते हो। जैसे जो भी डिजाइन क्लास से पास आउट हुए हैं उन सबको अगर आप एक साथ प्रेजेंटेशन करने के लिए डिस्प्ले करके रखेंगे ना, तो 10 लोगों का सबका कलेक्शन अलग रहेगा। हाँ, हमारा ट्रेडिशनल मोटिव डिजाइन वही रहेगा, पर कोई थीम है, कोई प्लेसमेंट में, कोई बॉर्डर में, कोई पल्लू में, कोई बुट्टी में, या बुट्टी में कोई इनोवेशन है, तो ये सारी चीजें देखने मिलती है। ये देख के बहुत अच्छा लगता है कि हम इस चीज को आगे ले जाएंगे और आने वाली जनरेशन को दे पाएंगे। और मार्केट भी यही मांगता है कि हर बार आप उनको तो कच्छ का वीविंग चाहिए, पर कच्छ की वीविंग के साथ थोड़ा और नया। कस्टमर यही सोचता है कि भुजोड़ी साइनिंग पहनूं, वो ऐसी पहनूं जो दूसरे के पास नहीं हो, मैं ऐसा कलर पहनू जो इसके पास नहीं हो, तो वो सारी चीजें हम ऑब्जर्व कर रहे हैं और उस चीज को नए मटेरियल वेरिएशन में भी हम जा रहे हैं। जैसे मैं बैम्बू फाइबर यूज करता हूँ, वो बहुत ही सॉफ्ट है और हम हर बार एग्जीबिशन में जाते हैं तो लोग बोलते हैं अरे ये वूल तो बहुत चुभता है, हमें सॉफ्ट चाहिए। तो हम वो सारी चीजें दिमाग में रखते हैं और उसको हम ट्राई करते हैं कि हम सामान में डालें, लोगों को नई चीज दें ताकि इसको हम और आगे ले जा सके।
बहुत आपके शब्द बहुत ही प्रेरणादायक हैं और आपकी सोच सुन के बहुत ही अच्छा लगा। जूही, यू हैव अ वेरी ब्रॉड एक्सपीरियंस इन हैंडीक्राफ्ट्स, पर्टिकुलरली हैंडलूम। व्हाट इज योर, व्हाट हैव यू सीन, हाउ हैव यू सीन थिंग्स इवॉल्व?
I think the journey for me is also a little personal. So I believe the inspiration to work with handlooms or handicrafts or with artisans starts from my home, and specifically I think my mother, who for many, many years stitched all our clothes, knitted all our sweaters, literally made like stitched our curtains, and it used to be very fascinating for me to see how she created stuff and etc. Along with my grandfather, who was a Gandhian and he never wore anything except khadi, and he didn't speak much, but the way he lived his life was very very out of the Gandhian philosophy, and it was just the mix of the two that also helped, wanted me to work in a space where there is expression, but expression for the benefit of people. I wanted to join the army, which couldn't happen because they were not taking women at that time. So the other space that I thought where I could be creative but also active landed up bringing me to design, and first to NIFT and then to NID. But the journey through those the two institutions actually then started opening out the whole world of textiles and weaving. And I was very interested in textiles more than fashion, actually, to an extent where my final collection at that point of time with NIFT, I used jute-based fabrics. And people thought, she's crazy. Who uses jute when everybody was using lycra and silks? And, that was what fashion was at in the 90s and late 90s. And I remember all my classmates calling me Jutey Juhi because my collection was all. But it was just the matter of understanding that, the natural material somewhere worked with me. And then when I went to NID, and, the whole philosophy of NID is to work with the ground-based ecosystem and look at what our traditions can take and take it forward from there. And I had the good fortune of working with a revival of three textiles while I was there as my last project, during a time when in 2001 we went through the earthquake, which shattered Kutch, and I volunteered in Kutch for 4 months at that time. Post that, in 2002, we had the Godhra riots. And these kind of disasters, man-made as well as natural disasters, one of the key factors that arose from there was, the communities who work with ground-based activities needing the most amount of support and facilitation rather than anything else. I worked with Mashru at that time, and Mashru had completely lost its importance in the entire industry, including the fashion industry. And it had changed to using only the rayon yarn and very rough fabrics, which then were sold only in the local market. But it was about how to revive that with not making it that expensive. So if we tried silk, the cost of the entire production was getting very high for the weaver. So it was introducing mercerized cotton as a separate yarn. And it was just a project that I did with two weavers, along with Ahmed Bhai Kamtiwala of Ahmedabad. And giving them just a second option, which was an easier option, but not as expensive as silk. It was 10 years later, so this is 2002, and 2012, when Ahmed Bhai was still alive, he called me one day and said, "Juhi Ben, humne aapka jo kapda tha na, wo hazaron mein bika hai. Ab ek exporter silk mein cha raha hai. Mujhe silk mein to karna hai, lekin mujhe silk yarn nahi mil raha." So that for me as a designer was a very, very important high point to say that it's not about just trying to create the product and, put my label and my brand, but it is this aspect of being able to facilitate a change which helps somebody or works for someone that, you know, makes their life easier or better or happier, gives me the high. It was just unfortunate that post me working with my projects in NID, and when I finished, I wasn't able to really secure a job, even though I had a NIFT and NID degree in the areas that I wanted to work in. So just like jaise Purushottam ji bol rahe the, log factory mein gaye aur fir wapas aaye ya factory aur isme, to mujhe wo bhi ek choice banani padi, and I shifted to the export industry because that was like the first job I got, and I had to do that because I think my parents had paid enough fees for me for 6 years, and I couldn't ask them for more money to work. So हमें अपने हाथ पैरों पे तो खड़ा होना था. तो आई टुक अप दैट जॉब एंड फॉर अबाउट द नेक्स्ट 7 years वर्क इन द एक्सपोर्ट इंडस्ट्री. बट कहीं पे दिल हरदम कोई भी हैंडमेड चीज देख के, आई एनी वे कंटिन्यू टू वेयर अ लॉट ऑफ खादी एंड एक्सेट्रा बिकॉज ऑफ द फैमिली बैकग्राउंड. दो आई वेंट इन टू एक्सपोर्ट्स एंड वी डिड वर्क फॉर बेन शर्मन एंड एफ सी यू के एंड ऑल द वेरियस ब्रांड्स पॉसिबल. बट दिल कहीं पे था कि आपको वापस you know, जहाँ आपका दिल है वहीं जाना है. So it was that 8 years, of course, taught me about industry, taught me about production, efficiency, quality, which is very important if you want to position yourself somewhere. How do you do that? And it was then that the confidence that ठीक है अब you know मैं छोटा भी कुछ करूँगी लेकिन अपने आप manage कर लूँगी. पैसे की ज़रूरत नहीं है, हमें corporate की ज़रूरत नहीं है, हम कुछ कर लेंगे. Simultaneously, it was also seeing how the education pattern had also changed, and you know, design schools were coming up in numbers already, and I'm now talking about 2007-8 and that point of time, where we were bringing in a lot of designers out into the market, but there was nothing of change or value that was coming in, and I somehow felt it was also a responsibility as a designer to even get into that space and see how we need to, you know, shift our way of thinking in terms of education as well. And hence it was a change and a shift that I made around 2010 to say, no, I'll try and now offer my expertise and services back to you know, the crafts community, the academic community, and see how we can connect those. And I started with actually setting up a very small, co-setting up a small organization in Goa. I moved there, which was to look at education and use design as a way of living and thinking for holistic purposes for children and women. And they were migrant communities that we actually worked with. So Goa mein bahut badi tadat mein Lambani community hai, which is the Banjaras who migrated from Rajasthan and moved to Karnataka, who used to come in for labor. But in the community, the men went out to work, but the women were still staying in their slums, but unko kuch karna tha. It was that rekindled the entire process of working with people again, and the real people, I call them the real people again, and interacting with them, sitting with those women, and they said, hum haath ka koi bhi kaam kar sakte, but jab aap unko bolo karne ke liye, then they'll have 600 different excuses. So you have to try and understand ki ye excuse kyun kar rahi ho, kyunki usko mehnat nahi karni. So how do I make something look very simple, to usko lagta nahi hai ki mehnat hai, but phir bhi she will do it. So that 4-5 year process of me being there helped me to understand, you know, that this is where the love for craft, love for handwork, love for community is. And I think I was just fortunate, I would say, that from Goa when I moved and I had a small assignment in NID, and I was going to take the next step. And typically, because I had not worked in the craft space for a long time, nobody really knew me. I never even thought that I could go back to crafts because there is a certain aura about the sector, which I won't get into. And I had one of my faculty, and he's probably listening to me, and I'm a little scared now, but he turned on and said that, listen, if you really want to work now and go out and do something new, go to Kutch. And I'm like, what's in Kutch? Because my heart was in Kutch, having worked there during the earthquake, having worked there throughout my time at NID. he said, you know, Khameer, there's an organization called Khameer, which I had heard of. And actually in 2008, when I became a freelancer, I had written to them and they had said, oh, we'll call you if we need you. But I never got a call and said, no, Khameer is looking for a director. And I think you will fit in very well. And I was like, no, I've been in the industry. I've done nothing to do with crafts for the last 12 years. Why would they take me? He said, Naini, you're meant for this. And long story short, met Meera Goradia, met Sushma Iyengar. They loved me for whatever reason. I loved Khameer when they invited me there for an interview, and I said yes. And I think that from 2016 to 2018, that kind of completely transformed my life, and you know, put that conviction in me as a designer that this is where I have to move towards. And having seen a transformation in Kutch because of my association since 99, what I realized is that this is a community that's very resilient. It has a pride for their work and their tradition and their skills. They are also very entrepreneurial. So what do they really need? They need, so is what I as a designer thought of when I went there, because Khameer had already worked very well in building the Kala Cotton value chain which introduced a new yarn, which again changed the whole story for the weaving community there. But there was still, where do you go next is what I started looking at, because they've figured out the skill, they figured out a new material, their markets were also increasing. But the next part was actually building a sense of ownership. ये नहीं कि मैं हरदम किसी का वेट करूं ऑर्डर के लिए, मैं अपना खुद का करूं. This had already started coming into the lives of the youngsters, जैसे पुरुषोत्तम जी ने बताया, through people like Judy Freighter, who set up Kala Raksha Vidyalaya, who set up after that Subhaya Kala Vidyalaya. And that niche, there was a niche that was being created, and that needed to just expand. And I also believe that when you are in a very rural environment, a very very rich ecosystem based environment, the ownership, the leadership should all be within that community, and people like us are supposed to be facilitators. This is again something that I truly believe was taught through my design education, where I was always told that design is a responsibility. You know, and that's the problem, that we have always just landed up looking at, if I say main designer hu, acha aap kya banate ho, said main logo ko banati hu, if that's okay for you. So it was about that sense of responsibility that said, if I am going to spend time here with the community, I need to build a relationship to offer them a facilitating arm to grow, and then to grow enough to say ab aapki zarurat nahi hai. If that is possible, if somebody you work with can reach that stage where then they say ki aapki zarurat nahi hai, for me that's success, because then you as a designer go somewhere else, and that is what your space is. So 2.5 years being in Kutch, I owe a lot to people like Purushottam and many others who gave me that trust, and ki nahi aap bataiye, हम लोग साथ में काम करेंगे, ये नया यान है. हम लोगों ने पूरा शीप वुल का वैल्यू चेन शुरू किया, जैसे वो बोल रहे थे कि द लोकल शीप वुल वाज वेरी कोर्स एंड इट हैड लॉस्ट इट्स मार्केट. सो द हर्डर्स देयर वर लिटरली ट्राइंग टू से कि हमको अब ऐसी नस्ल चाहिए कि हम बस अपना हाथ रब करें भेड़ पे और वो वुल निकल जाए, क्योंकि अब वो वुल यूजलेस हो गई है. बट दैट्स अ स्कैरी थिंग, बिकॉज the sheep cannot just be seen as an animal that gives you something. The sheep also as a breed balances your ecosystem. Yadi Kutch ki jo sundarta hai in terms of its geographical space is also because of all the various biodiversities that it has. Now aap nasal jo hai, jo original breed hai, usko hi aap nikal doge, then it is going to cause an imbalance in the system, and you're like, nahi ye nahi ho sakta. So but it was their support ki aap यदि आप ये कर सकते हो और आप हमें नया यान दे सकते हो हमारे देसी ऊन का, हम यूज करेंगे. सो इट वाज बिकॉज ऑफ द कम्युनिटी शोइंग एक्सेप्टेंस टू अ न्यू आइडिया इज व्हाई वी गेट द अपॉर्चुनिटी टू वर्क विद इट. इट्स नॉट अबाउट नहीं हम बोल रहे हैं तो आपको करना है. दैट in any sector, especially when you're working with people, and this goes even if it's the industry, you know, we have to, it has to be, as I say, always a give and take, not only just a one-way traffic, and definitely a relationship based give and take, not transactional. Ki hum main tumhe paisa de raha hu to tumko mera to kaam karna padega, main tumhari kyun baat sunu. So these are the small things in my journey that have, you know, brought me now to a space where I like it that there are people who've understood the idea of why we need to work with indigenous fibers. The need for us to, jab aap handloom bol rahe ho, to aap hand spinners ki bhi baat karo. Kyunki hand spinning ek bahut badi, it was a huge, huge employment generation arm for women. And wo humne pura wipe out kar diya by bringing in industrialization, including even khadi, that decided to make slivers and khadi units and then give it to the women to work on Ambar Charkha. You shouldn't have done that. Kyunki jo aapne spinning unit bhi lai, you got in the technology that would only work for long staple fiber and not the short staple fibers, which are actually our indigenous fibers. So, but there's now a big shift, and there are people and who are working towards trying to bring that back. और ये जो पुरुषोत्तम जी कच्च से बैठे हैं और अभी मेरा लेटेस्ट उदाहरण मैं वहीं का दे सकती हूँ, दैट विद द शीप वूल स्पिनिंग हैंड स्पिनिंग प्रोसेस दैट बिगैन, नाउ देर आर विमेन देर ऑल्सो हु आर स्टार्टिंग टू स्पिन कॉटन, हैंड स्पिन कॉटन, एंड देर लाइकिंग इट एज वेल. इट्स नाउ फॉर अस टू लुक एट इट फ्रॉम अ मार्केट परस्पेक्टिव, बट वो भी बन जाएगा जब आप वॉल्यूम्स क्रिएट कर देंगे तो फिर आपको मार्केट भी मिल जाएगा. बट इट्स अबाउट हैविंग दैट ट्रस्ट एंड फेथ विच इज द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट. एंड सो टूडे द स्पेस दैट माई जर्नी और वेयर आई सी हैंडलूम्स बींग कनेक्टेड टू मी एज अ डिजाइनर और एज अ सोशल डिजाइनर इज टू लुक एट हाउ वी क्रिएट दीज लोकल स्पेसिस अगेन. We create these local, the original local identities for them, for people and the value chains within the space. क्योंकि हर section में जैसे सुधा जी ने बोला कि अब आप कोटपाड़ में आल इस्तेमाल होता था क्योंकि वहाँ पे आल के पेड़ बेशुमार उगते हैं. वहाँ पे एरी सिल्क या मूगा यूज होता है क्योंकि वहाँ पे उसकी कल्चर की जाती है. तो उनके ट्रेडिशनल प्रोडक्ट्स भी उसी से बनते थे क्योंकि दे केम विद इन दैट फ्रॉम दैट इकोसिस्टम. कच्छ में हम लोग ज्यादा ऊन पहले पहनते थे एंड कम कॉटन क्योंकि कच्छ में मालधारियों का जो संख्या था उससे हमें ऊन ज्यादा मिलती थी. इट वॉज ओनली इन द नॉर्थ ईस्टर्न पार्ट ऑफ कच्छ जहाँ पे काला कॉटन उगता था और उगता है. तो हमें ये भी बहुत जरूरी है जानना कि इट इज विद इन दोज इको सिस्टम्स एंड वाई वी सर्वाइव्ड. एंड नाउ दिस इज द एरिया दैट आई वर्क इन, दैट वेयर यू हैव टू लुक एट क्रिएटिंग दोज लोकल स्पेसेस. क्योंकि वी आर सो रिच इन बायोडाइवर्सिटी, सुधा जी मेंशनड इट आल्सो, कि हर रीजन में आप नॉर्थ ईस्ट जाओ, कश्मीर जाओ, साउथ जाओ, हर रीजन में उसका एक यूनिक फाइबर है, हर रीजन में उसका यूनिक नेचुरल डाय है, हर रीजन में उसका यूनिक बुनाई कताई का भी काम है. और उसी को हमें वापस कैसे जोड़ना है इज वॉट वी नीड टू वर्क टूवर्ड्स, बिकॉज दैट विल हेल्प अस कीप अ बैलेंस्ड इकोसिस्टम. व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट सस्टेनेबिलिटी, कार्बन फुटप्रिंट, वी नीड टू थिंक अबाउट दिस एज डिजाइनर्स. इफ यू आर बाइंग Jamdani in Bengal, but you're taking it from Bengal to the south of India to dye it in natural indigo, and then from south of India bringing it to Delhi to convert it into your factory. Where's carbon footprint? It's gone. Where's sustainability? It's over. So somewhere we need to start becoming more conscious, and that's the area of work that now I'm pushing myself and pushing others to think about.
That's an amazing journey, Jogi, that you have shared, and you've also shared your vision for the future with us. So I'll now come to the future, the present and the future. I'll start with Pushottam bhai and in this current pandemic situation. Pushottam bhai, abhi ke sandarbh mein, abhi kaisa pandemic ki ye mahamari ki wajah se kya badlav aa rahe hain, aur aap apne handloom weaving ka bhavishya kya dekhte hain?
देखिए, कोरोना महामारी का तो पूरे भारत में और पूरे विश्व में है. तो जब ये लॉकडाउन हुआ तो ऑर्डर्स थे थोड़े बहुत, वो कैंसिल हो गए. और जो जान था सियान में ही हमने क्या किया कि हमारे कुछ ऐसे डिजाइंस थे जो बहुत टाइम से ऑर्डर के बीच में या कुछ उनका प्रोडक्शन नहीं हो पा रहा था, ऐसी चीज़ों को सिलेक्ट करके जो कोरोना का 3-4 महीना था उसमें हमने उसको वापस बनाया है, ताकि हम वो सक्सेस डिज़ाइन है उनको हमने बनाया है। अब मेन चैलेंजिंग ये है कि अब सामने सीजन आ रहा है, तो सीजन में अब प्रोडक्शन कितना करना और मार्केट खुलेगा कि नहीं खुलेगा वो अभी कुछ क्लियर नहीं है। 15 दिन में खुलेगा, 1 महीने में खुलेगा, नवरात्रि पे खुलेगा या दीपावली के खुलेगा, और दीपावली के बाद तो नवरात्रि के बाद तो हमारा सीजन चालू हो जाता है। तो ये एक बहुत ही दिक्कत वाला है प्रश्न कि अब हम क्या करें, स्टॉक करें। हाँ, एक चीज अच्छी है कि थोड़े थोड़े ऑर्डर आना चालू हो गए हैं, अगर वो ऑर्डर बढ़ते गए तो हम शायद सीजन भी अगर क्लियर हो गया तो हम इसको अच्छे से सामना कर पाएंगे, और एक सभी कारीगरों को थोड़ा थोड़ा हिम्मत मिलता जाएगा कि नहीं अब थोड़ा थोड़ा मार्केट खुलेगा। तो हमें हिम्मत नहीं हारनी चाहिए, और जिनके साथ हम काम कर रहे हैं वो लोग भी समझते हैं कि हम कारीगर हैं, हाथ से काम करते हैं, तो वो भी थोड़ा रिस्क उठाएंगे, हम भी थोड़ा हिम्मत करेंगे, और बाकी तो आगे देख लेंगे जो होगा, सब मिलके लड़ेंगे।
जमाल जी, आप क्या सोचते हैं भविष्य में क्या है, और अभी सिचुएशन कितनी गंभीर है, एंड व्हाट इज द फ्यूचर रियली?
यू सी द करंट सिचुएशन इज प्रीटी सीरियस, द होल सप्लाई चेन एंड द डिमांड एंड द इंटरनेशनल डिमांड, बिकॉज नाउ इट्स अ ग्लोबलाइज्ड वर्ल्ड, लॉट ऑफ हैंडलूम इज exported, etc. So everything is now pretty much broken. So we don't know when the supply chain and the demands will pick up. So that is one. But in the long run, my sense is, and whatever, there's very little data on handloom, but whatever little I've seen, I realize that it's very obvious that there is a growing demand for handloom products across the world. The exports from India are increasing, the domestic consumption is increasing. So there is no doubt that there is a growing demand for hand. This is the new sort of FMCG, as they say. People like to have personalized things in their home. Middle classes are booming, growing. They are now done with electronic goods. They want to do something personal and crafty and something which is genuine. So that is on one thing. But the other problem is that if you look at also the data and the fourth handloom survey, you realize that vast majority of our weavers come from a very, very poor and backward social and economic indicators. Many 70% haven't, more than 70% haven't gone to 10th, past 10th class. They don't have bank accounts. They live in, vast majority of them live in kaccha houses. So they are also very vulnerable for exploitation by the middlemen. So the growing demand is not trickling down to them in the sense of economic benefit. There is no harm in having middlemen. Middlemen have their own role in all these in the marketplace. But if the weaver is a informed weaver, an aware weaver, then he will be less vulnerable for exploitation and more will have more opportunity to benefit from the growing demand. So that's what my basic sense is. But however, this lockdown has really disrupted everything. And we don't know, because these are kind of products which are second on priority list. Essential goods are the first. So by the time the demand revives for this, it will take some time.
Sudha ma'am, how do you envision handlooms in future? How do you see? Ma'am, you're on mute, sorry.
Yeah, I found Parshottam spirits very, very amazing, because he is very positive about, you know, changing with times and bringing in changes in his craft and looking at different markets. In early days of pandemic, we realized that, you know, the artisans were working from homes, all the weavers, as it's a cottage industry mainly, people were working from home and whatever raw material they had, they were putting it in use and they had stocks of it. On various platforms, groups were made. I and Juhi, we were part of two groups, Hand for Handmade and Creative Dignity, where people collectively came together. It was a, you know, it was a movement, sort of a movement where NGOs, designers, and craft practitioners and enthusiasts came together. We, you know, they also tried to mobilize the artisans to come to a digital platform by creating catalogs of their stocks, doing pricing. In fact, this afternoon there was a workshop on costing of the material and things. So I think when people work as a collective, as a movement, new synergies will always come in. I think we need to look at it as a very bright, it's a, you know, in a positive sense that, you know, when people are coming together and helping people, artisans are also coming out and thinking that, yes, they can work with the digital medium. Tata Trust, Antaran, you know, there's a program up there called Antaran where they're working in few clusters. They came out with a catalog and the artisans, the weavers themselves were, you know, calling up to talk to us about when I placed orders for some ikat saris, he called up to ask me about certain specificities and things like that. So I think it's a fantastic medium where the artisan directly can come to a consumer. And I'm sure we'll all support this movement. And when you know that 95% of the handlooms come from India, I think we also have a responsibility to keep it, you know, keep it alive and also in turn benefit our weavers, you know, then only their children will follow the craft practices.
Thank you, ma'am. We've run the time of the webinar, but I'd still like to take a couple of questions because a lot of questions have poured in from the participants. And this one is for Mr. Kidwai. A student has, there's a question which is, it says, as a handloom enthusiast, how can we ensure that only real handloom is sold as handloom and not the power loom one, especially on online platform?
This is a tricky question because the thing is that people who want to cheat you will find ways to cheat you. The only way you can actually make sure that you buy genuine products is by educating yourself. And however, I am very positive about this because I'll give you a very quickly one small example. We were selling a dupatta, hand-woven dupatta with Sozni embroidery. Sozni was done in Kashmir, handloom was done in Badagaon. This young girl came and she looked at the dupatta and she said, what is this embroidery? So my colleague just said to her, this is Sozni, and she was with a young friend of hers. So quickly both of them, I noticed them, looked, Googled Sozni, and they both told each other the Sozni is actually a Kashmiri embroidery, this and this. And they immediately were right there and then. They had never heard it before, but they became aware of it. And now I also realize that increasingly when I go to exhibitions, etc., people come to us and they say, is it handspun, is it khadi? And I tell them, no, it's not khadi. Some of them come and say, is it handspun and hand-woven? So now suddenly you are actually realizing that there are customers and people are getting more aware because of the opportunities of information technology, etc. So, but to your question, I would say that the only way we can do it is make yourself aware, make customers aware and educate them.
Very true. Very well said. Thank you, Mr. Jamal. I'll take one more question which had come to us via email. The question is, handloom textiles are sustainable but expensive, which decreases their demand and makes them a luxury for users. How to bring them back for mass use? Or ye sawal pehle main Purushottam ji se karti hu. Purushottam ji, ye sawal hai ki hum handloom ko masses ke liye kaise laye? Ek luxury product banta ja raha hai kyunki ye bahut expensive hota ja raha hai. Aapka iske bare mein kya kehna hai?
देखिए
is there a problem?
Hello
yeah, there is some problem. Juhi, would you want to answer that while we try and fix Purushottam bhai's connection?
Yeah, so I believe that we have to, yes, we have made our handloom products on the luxury end, but it is our responsibility how to now create a second line. So I've been speaking to a few organizations who are saying ki, also this pandemic has made them realize that sab kuch sirf bahar nahi bech sakte, hame local bhi bechna hoga. So it's about also trying to look at the market. So jab pehle to hum log sab local ke liye banate the, it was the idea of commercializing it, giving them a larger livelihood that brought us into the space where we as designers, facilitators, entrepreneurs said ki ab hum ise bahar le jayenge, humne design development kiya, modification kiya, which we need kyunki wo zaruri hai. Lekin abhi hame ek aur line khada karna padega, which will work towards a much more local market. It's also about creating demand. Jab demand zyada hogi, which means the weavers will start getting more work, the spinners will start getting more work, it will eventually also bring out that volume based aspect of the weaving, which will bring the cost down because the person's getting more work. Right now it is also about the fact that the work coming to the weavers is niche. Lekin ek hi cheez that we have to be very careful is the handloom textile has to be designed in such a way that it is exclusive and only can be made on the loom. That is very important. Kyunki yadi jaise Purushottam ji said that when we started acrylic shawls in Kutch, eventually Ludhiana realized ki hum ise copy kar sakte hain. And the moment wo copy hone laga, our hand woven Kutchi shawls lost their value. So it is now about how you keep that hand value, which cannot be copied by our mills and our palus, because they will never stop copying us. If they started by copying us. So hame hardam ek step aage rehna hai. That's the only important factor. And then we can create a second line of products, which will be more affordable by a larger population of people.
Purushottam bhai, आप अपना इसमें व्यू दीजिए. आपको क्या लगता है मासेस के लिए कैसे ये लग्जरी प्रोडक्ट की जगह मासेस के लिए इसको हम कैसे बना, हैंडलूम को हम जगह अपने कंट्री में सबके सबके बीच में कैसे पॉपुलर कर सकते हैं?
देखिए, जो लोग वीविंग को जानते हैं, उसकी मेहनत, उसके पीछे जो काम है, एक लूम के पीछे चार लोगों पांच लोगों का हाथ होता है, तो मतलब जो लोग जानते हैं वीविंग को, उनको तो पता है. तो उनको वो पावर लूम और हैंडलूम के में जो लग्जरी मार्केट की और वो लो कॉस्ट के पास नहीं जाएंगे, क्योंकि वो समझते हैं. पर जो लोग पावर प्राइस के हिसाब से देखेंगे ना, तो उनके लिए उनको पहले हैंडलूम को समझना पड़ेगा कि हैंडलूम क्या है. अगर एक बार दोनों का डेफिनेशन समझ लेंगे ना, तो मुझे नहीं लगता वो प्राइस वाला सिस्टम आएगा. क्योंकि हैंडलूम ऐसी चीज है कि हैंडस्पन है, हैंड वोवन है, फिर उसमें लेडीज ताना निकालती है, फिर कांजी करते हैं, पूरा परिवार जाके एक एक तार करके अलग करता है, फिर वो जॉइनिंग होता है पूरे तार. तो मतलब वो मेहनत ही इतनी है कि कोई भी अगर पावर लूम भी नाम लेगा ना, तो भी उसको मना बोलेगा नहीं, मुझे हैंडलूम ही लेना है. तो वो एक लगाव ही उस तरफ खींच के लाएगा. रही प्राइस की, तो वो उसके लिए उसको हैंडलूम के बारे में ऐसे कारीगर या ऐसे किसी से कुछ नॉलेज लेना पड़ेगा, तो ही इसका डेफिनेशन पता चलेगा.
थैंक यू पुरुषोत्तम भाई. वी हैव बीन जॉइंड बाय डायरेक्टर लिफ्ट गांधीनगर डॉक्टर ए के खरे. आई इनवाइट डायरेक्टर सर टू extend a vote of thanks. I request him to thank all our panel members and the participants. Sir, would you like to speak a few words?
Thanks so much. In fact, I joined the discussion at the fag end because I was in another meeting. But I think it was pretty fruitful discussions. Juhi ji, aap NIFT Gandhinagar se hi hain kya?
Nahi sir, main NIFT Chennai se hoon. I was from the second batch of NIFT Chennai, तो तब गांधीनगर था नहीं.
हाँ, ऐसा कैसे हो गया कि चेन्नई था और गांधीनगर नहीं था, दोनों साथ साथ
में आए? 96.
अच्छा, you talking textile design, right?
No, fashion. There was no textiles for undergraduate when I joined NIFT.
Okay, I'm saying so. I think it was a wonderful discussion, in fact. But and I'm saying, आप सब लोगों को sixth handloom दिवस के लिए बहुत बहुत बधाई. And wonderful efforts by Dr. Ms. Sumita as well as the entire textile design team. But I'm saying we should continue these kinds of dialogue discussions with I also see a very good participation for this webinar. So let's continue this our initiatives in order to actually help ultimately our handloom sector. Thanks so much. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, all the panelists. Thank you, Director, sir. You've given us a lot of food for thought. And though these stories may be small and individual, but they are like, jaise Jamal ji ne bola, these are drops, but the drops make the ocean. So you all are making the ocean around us. Thank you so much. Have a very nice day and good evening. Namaskar.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye. Bye. Bye.